All right. Hello, and welcome to another Expert Insight interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM, joining you from San Diego. A bit chilly, San Diego, actually, as you can tell. I have a little bit of a cold. Who knew? Who knew it could get chilly here? But it does. But today I am delighted to be joined by Amanda Abella, who is over in Miami, Florida. I'm sure it's beautiful over there right now.
It is gorgeous, and it's starting to cool down a little bit. So maybe not as chilly as San Diego, but it cooled down a little bit today. It's amazing.
Yeah, but when it cools down in Florida, like it cools down to like San Diego weather, to be honest. I mean, it becomes beautiful, doesn't it? All right. Well, Amanda is the founder and CEO of Make Money Your Honey, a marketing and sales training company that helps women coaches, consultants, and creatives triple their revenue while working half the time. And we're going to talk about sales skills and why you need them. So, Amanda, let's just baseline this for a moment. Like, you know, if you asked 100 salespeople, you know, are sales skills important? Obviously, they'd all say yes. And if you asked 100 CEOs, is sales skills and sales training important? They'd say yes. But if you followed up with the question, how much money are you going to invest in it this year? You maybe get one or two who may step forward. So what I'm saying is, a lot of people pay lip service to the idea of selling skills and all that, but the reality is a lot of people don't invest in them. And what do you think the downside of that is?
To be honest, I have no idea, because I personally just invested about $60,000 in sales training for my company. And I'm like, this is a no-brainer. what I will say, right, is I work with more small businesses, and there people have a fear of selling, so they might give it lip service, but that doesn't mean they're not afraid of it.
Right. And I guess that's a great point, because I do think, you know, you talk about small businesses and entrepreneurs and stuff, and sometimes, you know, they get into this because they're passionate about the business or the product or the service or whatever they do, but they don't consider themselves a salesperson. And they also have that hangover of all the negative things that are said about salespeople or how they're portrayed, etc. So they kind of reluctantly, like kicking and screaming, go into sales.
Mm-hmm. I know I did. I went into it kicking and screaming. I completely understand. You know, I've had team members go into it kicking and screaming, clients go into it kicking and screaming. I totally get it. And I think another part of it is, before I was a sales trainer, I basically wrote about finance for 8 years. And I think it also has to do with our relationship to money, because if you're saying you don't like sales, you're basically saying you don't like money. So, and then on top of that, we have such weird relationships to money and what that means for us. And I think that also plays a really big part of it, because when you start going nitty gritty into it, that's when you start hearing stories. Well, I heard growing up rich people are evil, right? Or I heard that in order to make money, you have to be like a used car salesman. Although with my audience, they're like bro marketers or the new used car salesman. And they're afraid of becoming those guys that they're like, they only care about the money. They don't care about helping people. When in reality, it's a misconception, because in order to get really good at sales and build a sustainable business, priority number one is helping people. But we don't understand that.
No, you're 100% correct. And I think the other thing that speaks to that nowadays is that there's not a huge amount of perception-wise, customers generally see products and services as extremely commoditized. Now, they don't see a massive difference between them. What often differentiates today is the experience they have working with the company, and that starts with the salesperson. And therefore, the salesperson who is the helper, who really wants to understand their issues, really wants to help solve their problems, as you said, those are the people who win. And it's such a great thing to be a problem solver for somebody. Like, it's such a fantastic thing to be.
Yeah, it feels really, really good. So, you know, I've been training clients for years. Now I'm training team, and that's part of what I'm showing them, right? I'm like, look, this is about solving problems for people first and foremost. And when you look at it from that perspective, it's amazing how when people understand it from that perspective, all these preconceived notions kind of, you know, slip away. You know, we'll do sales role play with my team. We'll do it with clients. And then someone's really hearing it for the first time. And then they're like, wait a second, that's not at all what I thought it was. Because it's all these preconceived notions of stepping on people to make money. That's what most people have. That's their perception. And on top of that, we've all, as a customer, at some point, we've all had a horrific sales experience or a horrific customer service experience. And then we make the assumption that that's what it is when we have to go do it. Oh, I have to learn how to do that. No, that person didn't know what they were doing. Mm-hmm. But because we don't have that knowledge and we don't have that training, back to your point, we just don't know.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great point, because yeah, we tend to focus in on the bad actors and try and generalize in a way, to be honest with sales, in a way that we don't do with a lot of other roles, even though we probably have worse experience sometimes with the other roles, but for some reason we don't react in that way. But I think you raise a fantastic point, is that when you show people the correct way of doing it and when you point out the incorrect way of doing it, I think it changes the perception completely.
Completely. Yeah. I mean, we had team members who were really nervous when we started doing it, and then I showed it to them and they're like, wait a minute, that's actually totally fine. That's actually pretty cool. You know, and then suddenly all the nerves and the frustration and the stress started to melt. You know, it's the same thing with a lot of clients, that once they, and the truth is, sales is equal parts, you know, mechanics, science, and art. It's both, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. And in my company, we try and teach people both so that they can see how they work together and they get a holistic view of sales. And honestly, at least in the online space where I live, a part of the problem is a lot of people are just trying to look for some sort of a tactic or a trick in order to make more money. Like, that is a sector of the client base, mm-hmm. or customer base, that's what they're looking for. And that also perpetuates the problem because they're not in a place of integrity.
Yeah, no, that's a fantastic point you raised there, Amanda, because I do think that this whole like culture of hacks and shortcuts, we live in this culture, we live in a shortcut culture. And if you get sucked into that in sales, it's, you're not going to have a good time, and you are going to come across as one of those people, because there are no shortcuts to doing it the right way.
None. There are no shortcuts. I posted last week on my personal Facebook page. I said, listen, my company's having one of our best sales weeks ever. We closed 81,000 in sales in a week.
Congrats.
Which, thank you. Right. It was a big deal. I almost fainted. I was like, wait, let me run that calculator one more time. Did we really just do that? But I posted and I was very clear. And I said, guys, this is a decade of work. This is a decade of training. This is a decade of taking risks with my money, with my time, with my energy. It's a decade of sacrifices and choices. I was once rejected 60 times in 1 month and had to get back up and do it again. I've had the wrong product. I had to tweak the product. I had to redesign everything. There've been tons of failures to get to this point. I have put in the 10,000 hours.
Yeah. So basically you're an overnight success that took 10 years.
That took 10 years, exactly.
but there's a really key point in here, because as I said, I mean, people look now and they see these, you know, like they see YouTubers come out of nowhere with millions of followers making loads of money, just goofing around. And they all think, oh, there's got to be shortcuts to everything. But they don't see the 10 million other people who tried this and failed.
And you know, I help my clients expedite the process so they don't have to make all the mistakes that I made. Sure. And one of the things that I do is, you know, we're going to cross over into the 7-figure mark in the next few months. You know, I'm looking at, okay, well, there's working hard and there's working smart. So the ones who get results very quickly, I have found that they understand the working smart thing maybe faster than the rest of us do, right? And that goes back to either they had exposure to it, right? Usually they had exposure to it in some way, whereas most people did not. And it also goes back to the conversations we have about money. Again, it all goes back down to this root conversation we have about money, where we tell ourselves making money needs to be hard. It needs to be a struggle. I can't tell you how many business owners I work with who are grossly undercharging themselves for a mountain of work, and they just don't have the proper structures and systems in place to make it efficient. So they're trying to sell, you know, and they don't run the math, right? So they're trying to sell these low price point offers, trying to make, I don't know, $1 million in the next 12 months. And I'm like, well, why don't you just sell something for $25,000? And then you have to talk to less people. So, but again, we're not taught that, right? We're not taught to even look at these things. We're not taught to strategize that way. We're taught that it needs to be a struggle. I never had access to anything. I don't have entrepreneurs in my family. You know, everything's been bootstrapped. Everything's been mistakes from the ground up. I wish I had access to mentorship like people do now 10 years ago, but it wasn't around.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think today, and as I say this, and I apologize to the listeners and viewers for repeating myself so often, but I say this all the time, is that we are happy to invest money in our hobbies, right? People will get golf coaches or tennis coaches or whatever. But investing money and time and effort in developing the skills that actually put bread on the table, that's where a lot of people fall down. And to your point is now, I mean, once upon a time, when I first did my first executive coach, I mean, they were local. They used to come into the office after work and we would do, I mean, now you can have coaches and mentors from anywhere. So, I mean, there's no excuse anymore.
None whatsoever. You know, it definitely wasn't around when I was starting on this journey. So yeah, you can expedite the process. I mean, I have clients getting in 2 years what it took me 6 years to do, but it's because they've had more exposure. I see these young teenagers making money on YouTube. Yeah, because they grew up with YouTube. They had more exposure, you know, than people in older generations. But for the most part, you also don't know the amount of work that they're doing behind the scenes. And that's the part people forget about, is the amount of work required behind the scenes to make these things happen. And that failure is a part of the process, and that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's the part that gets brushed under the carpet. So, you know, it all looks like, oh, it's all fantastic and easy. But the hard part is, you know, people obviously don't talk that much about. But what would you say in terms of, you know, I think pre-pandemic this was happening, and certainly the pandemic has exacerbated it or increased it. But I think there's a real hunger now for integrity, for authenticity, for real connection when you're working, regardless of whether it's sales, on the sales side or on the buying side. I think there's a real hunger for authenticity, connection, and honesty.
Absolutely. And I think that's why funnels are not as effective as they used to be. So we've worked with a lot of, and I have funnels in my business. I have automated systems, you know, because you can't scale a business without them.
Sure.
You know, you need to systematize things. You need technology and you need people. However, and I've really been banging on this since the pandemic started, right? I said, oh, you're about to see the difference between marketers and people who actually know how to sell. Because when stuff gets crazy, marketers are really going to struggle because they let all the marketing, and then it's like easy. Salespeople know how to deal with the biggest objection right now, which is uncertainty.
Yeah. I had an interesting conversation as a number of years back. It was just after the, I guess it was a financial crisis when I was running Huthwaite, a sales consultancy, and I talked to a company, the head of a sales in a company, and they were lamenting that. They said, my sales team used to be fantastic and now they're struggling. And I said, but were they fantastic? Or were they operating at a time when budgets were, you know, bloated, people were spending, it was easy to sell pre-financial crisis, it was easy to sell. And now afterwards, now to your point, now you're going to know who the real salespeople are.
I mean, my company's more than doubled its revenue this year, but I also know how to sell. And I solve a really big problem and I put myself in position. But one thing that's interesting is in the online spaces where I live, there's been a lot of reliance on funnels and launches and all these kinds of things. At the time of recording this, a couple of weeks ago, Facebook and Instagram went down while people were in the middle of launches. Yep. It destroyed their launches, you know? Meanwhile, I was fine. I've been at an event all weekend. I had a bunch of leads. I was calling them. I was making sales. I was on track to have the best sales week of my business, right? I was not worried about Facebook or Instagram or any of those things. Or another complaint that I'm hearing a lot is that conversions aren't what they used to be. You know, ad costs have tripled in the last decade. They're going to triple again. And I keep telling people, you must learn sales skills. Right? Because this is the only thing. Well, I would say you must learn actual marketing psychology and skills, and you must learn sales skills, right? Because the consumer has gotten smarter. They want people with integrity. I swear I close like 70% of my sales because people love that I curse on my podcast. And I show the behind the scenes of how hard this has actually been for me, mm-hmm. and the fact that it has been a challenge. I swear that's why I close so many people, because they tell me all the time.
Yeah, that's funny.
Right?
But to your point there, though, is about you know, really learning how to sell, because you're right, because as people get savvier, as yes, so you're not going to have the same leads, you're not going to have the same return on your, you know, it's more expensive to acquire. Therefore, when you acquire a prospect, you need to be able to actually close that prospect in the best way possible, like help them and close them. So your sales skills have become even more important now, given the scarcity of the leads.
Exactly. Scarcity of the leads, how expensive everything has gotten. The leads have gotten smarter. And to your point, they want to make sure that they're working with legitimate people. That's been a huge thing. I cannot tell you how many conversations I have every week. We work with women, so I'm going to generalize here. Yeah. I'm sure it happens to the men as well, right? Where they've spent tens of thousands of dollars on business coaching and nobody taught them how to sell. And then that's why they haven't made a return on their investment. Or they're teaching strategies that worked in 2012, but not in 2021. We kind of went through an earth-shattering, world-changing situation in the last couple of years that has really, you know, required you to sharpen your sales skills.
Yeah.
You know, every week we're having those conversations. So the consumer's feeling burned. The consumer is like, no, I know all about the funnels. I've tried the funnels. I'm not getting results. The conversions aren't there. They're frustrated on top of it. So a marketer doesn't know how to deal with that frustration, right? Because they'll probably use some psychological pressure tactic, right? Whereas a salesperson will be like, okay, well, what is the problem and how can we solve it for you?
Yeah. No, I think it's incredibly important, because I think the other part is, while the buyers are more savvy and all of that and more informed, they're also overwhelmed because there's so much stuff coming at them. So as a salesperson, if you can cut through the noise and really get to the heart of their issues, they're going to love you.
They're going to love you. You know, I had a call earlier today that I closed, and she's like, I never read everybody's sales pages. I read yours, because it was real. Like, you didn't sugarcoat anything. Right. And then when I saw her application come through, I was like, oh, we're about to solve this problem in 20 minutes. You know, I knew I was going to close her, but I knew exactly where she was, what stage she was, what the problems were, what she was going to say, you know, and that comes from, you know, thousands of hours of calls, trainings, you know, having conversations with people, getting training myself, plus training other people. I know what's going to come out of their mouths before they say it. And I know how to fix the problems in 20 minutes, right? What that does is that it shows the buyer, oh, this person has certainty and they actually know what they're talking about. Yes, yeah. I do.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly. Because at the end of the day, you want to show that you're a skilled professional.
Right. Exactly. And they will come back to me and they'll be like, look, I've had experiences. This is another one with the follow-up. I've had people that come back to me because I find out they had surgery and I send them a get well card. Yes, they're a lead I'm working on, but I send them a get well card when I found that out. They come back and they're like, I'm going to buy from you because I've spoken to other people and no one ever sent me a get well card. Like, I never heard from them again after I spoke with them one time. You're the only person who's actually, you know, kept in touch with us. Or, you know, we have certain funnels where people can buy lower price point offers. My team is calling those people every day. And what we will get is, you're the only person who's ever reached out to us after a $27 purchase. Most people just ignore us.
You see, that's such a fantastic point there you just made about the follow-up, about treating every customer like they're a customer. And not like segmenting them out and going, well, just ignore these small purchases. And the other thing is, if you send me a get well card when I'm in, you know, hospital having surgery, yeah, of course I know you're a salesperson. Of course I know you're staying kind of, but I'm looking at you as a hardworking salesperson, somebody who's really taking an interest. And I think, well, if you can find out about that, and if you can take the time out to send me a get well card, then you'd probably work pretty hard on my behalf.
Exactly. And I think people are craving that. They want to know that people are going to work hard on their behalf.
Yeah. And I think that's a fantastic point. A fantastic point to end on. I think if there's one takeaway, is that's this. It's people want people who will work hard on their behalf. So as a salesperson, you have to show them that you are going to be that person. You're going to understand their problems. You're going to work really hard to solve them, and you're going to be there for them, and you're genuine and authentic.
Absolutely. I couldn't have put it better myself. That was perfect.
Yeah, all right. Well, listen, all of Amanda's information is going to be below this video and links so you can find out more. But before we go, Amanda, please do tell people a little bit more about you and your business.
Yeah, so I run Make Money Your Honey. It's a marketing and sales training company. We help with women, coaches, consultants, and freelancers, basically who are in that position that they're ready to scale. So we help them with systems, we help them with offers, we help them with building their influence, and we talk sales. Half the program is just sales. You know, a lot of these women have gotten training on inbound sales. Many of them don't get training on outbound sales. Yeah. We teach both.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Well, that's a whole other, we could talk a whole other thing about inbound and outbound, but there'll be another whole half hour. All right. Well, listen, thanks again, Amanda. Thank you all for listening and watching, and I will see you for another interview really soon. Thank you.